back. We're talking with J.D. Messenger. He has written 11 Days in May, and it's published by Waterfront Digital Press. Welcome, J.D.
It's an honor to be here.
And 11 Days in May followed January 20th, when you broke your neck a second time.
Correct, in 2000.
And how did this affect you?
Well, it was pretty significant. I had injured my neck in a submarine accident in 1985.
That's when you were a captain of a submarine.
Well, I wasn't a captain, but I was, one of the senior officers on the submarine. And we were refueling the nuclear reactor in overhaul in Newport News. And it was late at night. It's kind of like a Tom Clancy setting.
Yeah.
It was winter time, and it's foggy out, and there's sparks and arc welders, and the submarine's cut to pieces like Swiss cheese. We're 80 feet in the air, and the nuclear reactor's open, and it looks like a blue glowing hole. So I'm supervising these operations, and a crane load came and swung, and I saw it in my periphery, and I had a fraction of a second to decide whether I wanted to jump in the reactor pit or go down 90 feet in the hole or get hit. And, of course, by the time I turned, the beam hit me and it snapped my neck back.
Yeah.
So that was a precursor in the first time it
after
was broken.
That
was 1985.
Yeah. But after that, you were CEO in China?
Correct.
For Ernst & Young.
Ernst & Young Consulting. So flash forward 15 years, my neck had recovered. I had gone through two careers. I was the Exxon executive that supervised Valdez oil spill, and then I became an Ernst & Young partner. I'm traveling around the world putting in power systems and energy systems and advising the Prime Minister of Singapore. And
were you married at the time?
I was, yes. Been married for 30 years.
Uh-huh.
Yep, three children.
Did your wife travel with you?
Well, she certainly moved to Singapore when we moved to Singapore. I assume that's what you mean.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the family was with me.
Yeah. The reason I'm asking, one of the prime moving parts of this book is going back to the idea of love. And you say, I discovered that every time I made a decision with love in mind, my life was balanced, happy, and also successful. However, when I made choices in favor of security, prestige, wealth, or power, those decisions literally made me sick.
Absolutely. And the
expound on that a little.
Well, let me, if I may, finish and say what happened on January 20th, when in 2000, that's when I broke my neck. Again, my neck had started deteriorating. The statement you just read is a realization of what happened to me.
Yeah.
And so if I may, I'll finish saying that. My neck had been hurting for 6 months, from 1999 in the summer to January, and it was slowly deteriorating. So I finally, one morning, January 18th, 2000, I put my arms in the air to stretch, and that last pop was the thing that broke whatever was last hold of my neck together. And I died. I left my body. I went through a tunnel and a whole bunch of amazing things. The paragraph that you just read was basically a realization a couple of months later, you know, after I'm laying in bed, my nerves are crushed, I have no feeling here.
You're lucky you weren't a paraplegic.
I was in really bad shape. I mean, they took bone out of my neck to put my hip to put my neck together. So I had to learn how to walk and talk and chew gum all over again.
Mm-hmm.
And I was really depressed. I mean, I here I was sort of a, you know, not a double A battery, a triple A battery, always trying to climb the ladder and do the next bigger thing. And, you know, I thought I was important. And here I was laying on my back, and all I could do was stare at the plaster in the ceiling. And so I got very depressed, and I cried a lot. And, you know, as I began to examine my life, who am I? Why am I here? Why am I? I'm supposed to be happy. Why am I not happy? And that's when I realized that, you know, I evaluated my life. And I went back and evaluated every job, every opportunity, and I discovered that the ones that I had where I was happy and healthy and fit was when I was following my heart, doing what I love.
I should tell our friends in the audience that this book is written as conversation with another person. And it's as if the person is living in you, which of course is what it does turn out to be. And it is a challenging person who doesn't always give you the answers.
No, the book is titled 11 Days in May because it was written in 11 days in May of 2012. There was no intention of writing a book. I did not know I was writing a book. There was no structure. There was no plot. One of the things that happened to me after I died and came back is I call it the writing on the wall, or WOW, or wow effect.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is 2012, so it's 12 years after. You know, I've had a lot of unbelievable miracles and experiences happen to me. But so I was meditating and praying, and when I pray, I get answers, and I just see the writing. And so I just went into my office and started writing.
Mm-hmm.
And I had no idea I was writing a book. And I wrote for 11 days straight. And when I was done, my wife said, "What have you been doing in your room for 2 weeks?" And I said, "I think I wrote a book." She said, "Well, what's it about?" And I said, "I don't know. I haven't read it yet."
Yeah.
So this conversation is between myself and this unnamed friend, which is a spoiler if I describe who it is, but I'll just say it's a real conversation. There's no other person really present.
Don't you think a lot of people have that?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I received 100,000 emails in the first 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
The book was originally called Just 11 Days in May, but so many people said, oh my God, thank you, you changed my life in 3 days, that we added this tagline,
yeah,
the conversation that will change your life. And I mean, the stories that, you know, they just make you cry, Connie. I mean,
yeah,
you just, it's the greatest gift I think an author could have, to know that, you know, I'm getting goosebumps all over me, which that's one of the parables, is goosebumps or truth bumps.
Yeah.
That you helped someone.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so many people that, you know, yes, I, you know, we can all talk to God and get answers from God, or talk to our higher self.
Yeah. You also talk about almost drowning.
Yes. I've actually almost died 3 times.
Yeah, I'm listening. And I'm reading and listening.
The first time was when I was 18. My father had died of cancer, and he had given me the first gift I'd ever had. We didn't grow up having much in our family. We were living in New York and Long Island, and we had 5 children, and I was the youngest, and so I had, everything was a hand-me-down.
Mm-hmm.
I can remember the first new pair of pants I got and how unbelievable I felt, you know. And,
yeah,
and so my father gave me this beautiful new watch for my 18th birthday, and 6 months later he died.
Yeah.
And so I went to Annapolis and the Naval Academy, and I was sailing at Annapolis in a race, and the watch band broke, and the watch slid across the hull and just went bloop in the,
yeah,
water, you know? As a sailor, I've got this theory, the more valuable and precious something is, the more silent the bloop is when it goes in the water. And so I let go of everything, and I dove in after it. Now, it was in the wintertime,
mm-hmm,
and I had foul weather jacket on. I had sweats underneath and all that, and I watched it go down like this, and it went like this, and I grabbed, and it went like that. And then,
yeah,
then I reached over here, and I just kept going deeper and deeper. And I turned around finally after about 18, mm-hmm, 20 feet, and I couldn't go up.
Mm-hmm.
And my clothes were, you know, I was... boots, everything filled with water. So I quickly started stripping my clothes off, and I got the jacket and the boots.
Yeah.
I couldn't get the pants, you,
yeah,
know, I couldn't get the snaps off, but I started to go up, and I was out of air, and I,
yeah,
just, you know, I started to drown.
Part of the book too is change, and there's a great sign: to see no change in change is to understand the essence of change. How did you change from that watch going down?
The parable or the story about the watch to me is really all about attachments. You see, and it relates to the suffering that I did after breaking my neck and thinking that who I was what I did, you know, my job, my title. You know, I believe that attachments are the source of suffering. Mm-hmm. And after I had lost that watch, I was really angry and upset for 4 days.
Yeah.
You know, I was mad at the world.
Yeah.
And I went into the chapel at the Naval Academy in Annapolis, which if you've ever been there, it's just one of the most beautiful chapels. It's where we actually got married, my wife and I. And I just prayed to God, you know, why did this happen to me? And, you know, I grew up as a Roman Catholic, and I was taught to pray, but they never taught me to listen. And somewhere along the line, I learned to listen, because if you listen, you get answers. And sometimes the answers come in a voice, sometimes it's a feeling, sometimes strangers come up and say something to you. You get answers all the time. And I got an answer, and it was, you know, the watch wasn't important, you know. It was the love to your father, and that attachment represented that love. But this is the essence of suffering. You know, we get attached to what I call things in the world of form.
Yeah. And meanwhile, it is quite it's not a book to be read in 11 days. Though.
No. Well,
because, each chapter has something that you can mull over. Mm. And you mull how it relates to you as well as to the world. And they will have to read the one about science, because that is a fascinating chapter. Thank you so very much, J.D., and it's
Thank you.
Pleasure meeting you. Will you sign
Absolutely.
My book?
Yeah, absolutely.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson. You can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier. But the most important thing you can do, support your local library. Libraries are our finest democratic institution in America. Whatever you can do, donate, volunteer, support them. And we'll see you next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.